What's up? This is Rebel Radio.
What up? What up? This is DJ Newmark.
This is Peanut Butter Wolf.
It's your boy. It's okay.
Keep checking out Rebel Radio.
Rebel Radio.
This is Rebel Radio.
We're in the place right here. Rebel Radio is going down.
Would you say Rebel Radio?
Oh, wait. Let's do it again.
Rebel Radio.
What's up, Rebels? Welcome back to Rebel Radio, the weekly show where I bring you the rebels that are shaping youth culture. We talk about how they do it, why they do it, and what you can do to get a little piece of the pie for yourself. We're also the only show to bring you new music every week from our friends over at EDM.com. I'm your host, Josh Levine, and my guest in studio is Kenny Larkin, the Detroit techno legend. He's a DJ producer extraordinaire, and for those of you, my dance music heads will know that Detroit techno is really the foundation for all modern dance music. It's where it all started. And my hip-hop heads will know that there's a real connection between Detroit techno and hip-hop that was happening at the time. And Kenny and I talk a little bit about that song, the one particular song that started it all. Kenny's like your favorite DJ's favorite DJ. He's a guy that some people may not know, but he's had a huge impact on a lot of people that you do know and love. He's also spent some time working as a comedian, and he talks a little bit about some of the stops and starts he's had in his career. I think there's some great lessons to take from Kenny and his dedication to creativity, and how that's really cemented his legacy, even though in some ways maybe not the most productive business decisions. So we get into some of that in this interview. I hope you enjoy it right after our EDM.com track of the week.
You can see it tattooed on me, tattooed in my blood.
Yo, that was Choice with Tattoo, the EDM.com track of the week. If you like that one, get over to EDM.com and check out more new music. Right now, let's get into the interview with Kenny Larkin. Cool, man. Well, thank you for doing this.
Okay, yeah, no worries.
I'm excited to dig into your story. You're, as we talked about, you know, we met many, many years ago, but haven't really got to know each other.
Okay, yeah, yeah.
And you're like the kind of person I love to have on the show, because you're like you're a bit of like an unsung hero. You're sort of the producer's producer.
Yeah, yeah. For sure. That's we all. Yeah, yeah.
How come
brothers always end up in that fucking situation?
Is that what it is?
I don't know. Like, you like the jazz guys. You know? They got the respect back in the 50s and shit. They had to go to Europe and get their props. But
right.
Back in the States.
I mean, there's a lot of parallels between techno and jazz, right?
I'm not going to get all...
If we want to start there.
I'm not going to do all that stuff. I'm not going to get all, like, controversial and, you know, what do you call it? Conspiratorial. I'm not going to do all that stuff. But it's kind of like that.
No, but it's true. I mean, so anyway, I don't know the answer to that question. Mm-hmm. But I'm glad, I think, you know, as a music fan, you know, lifelong fan of music, we meaning the world, needs the people that inspire the people that get famous.
Yeah, for sure.
Right?
Yeah.
And so I want to talk to you about it because it's a weird role to play.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and I don't know that you necessarily chose that when you set out.
I'm more of an integrity kind of guy
than
trying to flip my script and do stuff just to kind of go with the flow.
Okay.
I mean, and then, you know, obviously there's consequences from that.
Of course.
Or lack of opportunity. I'm not as, quote, famous. I like to say I'm famous for not being famous.
Yeah.
Right, right? Yeah. Because, like you said, the artists know who we are big time. I mean, I have a ton of stories of huge artists that I've met or come across or what. And for instance, Oakenfold. I saw Paul Oakenfold in the Starbucks down the street.
Uh-huh.
You know, and then we saw each other. Right, oh, my God, what's up, Kenny?
Yeah.
Same with Daft Punk.
I did
a live show. I did this live show in Paris. And it was on TV, and they invited all these people to come and check out this live show. It was a taping, and it was a filming of this thing. And at the end, I found out Daft Punk was there. I was like, seriously?
Yeah.
And so all these people, they come up to you, and they go, oh my God, I grew up to your music,
yeah.
Right? but yeah. their fans don't yeah. know who you are.
Yeah, because for sure.
It's a
for sure. Yeah. I mean, it's part of the game. So let's dig into that. But tell me how it started for you, way back. Do you remember the first record you ever bought?
Oh my God! Wow. No.
No.
I do not remember the first. No, that's a fuzzy.
What about like the first music that you just fell in love with?
Motown, of yeah. course. I mean, that's, you know.
Sure.
I grew up in Detroit, so my mom was heavily.
Yeah.
that was the soundtrack of the late 60s. I was born in 68. So.
What was the so obviously, you know, Motown has affected every pocket in the world. Mm-hmm. But what was it like in Detroit? Like we know it was like in here in LA with, you know, West Coast hip hop, mm-hmm. meaning there's a community of people mm-hmm. that were involved directly, right? So what was that like in Detroit? Being, you know, you were just after that real kind of Motown so era.
Musically or?
No, just like.
Just in general?
Like, culturally, like oof. Like walking, you know, living in that city where all this is coming know, from.
Well, you know, we grew up in the neighborhood that we grew up in was bad, but not bad in the.
But Detroit has layers. I mean, every city
for
does.
For sure, right? Okay, degrees
every city
of.
Right.
Who's bad? Okay, are you really bad? Are you damn, bro? You okay? We weren't in the thick of the fucking like. Yeah. It wasn't like going down like that, but it was still bad enough to where my mom said, "You know what? I want to get these guys out of here."
Yeah.
So that was at, you know, sixth grade. We were able to, and below the sixth grade, I mean, at my age, at our age, we weren't able to get into too much trouble,
sure,
right?
Of course.
So she
your
caught
kids.
It right. I mean, she caught yeah. it right at the perfect time
yeah.
to get us out of the city.
Yeah.
So, but. We did get into some trouble though as kids,
mm-hmm.
just by being on the block with these,
for sure.
these kids, right?
Yeah.
So, and the sad thing is that the majority of the people that we hung out with either died or went to jail. Okay,
yeah.
So that's the whole, that's the same.
For sure.
Right, that's the same script for a lot of guys that grew up in the inner city.
Yeah.
So, but the cool thing was when she took us out of the city and we went to the suburbs, somehow we started. Our musical horizon kind of broadened, and right, that was right around the time when everybody knows the story about Mojo, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know Mojo? Do you know Mojo? Do you know the?
No.
You don't know who Mojo is?
No.
Oh my God. Okay. Techno would not be techno. Detroit. I'm surprised.
Not Lady. You're not talking about Lady.
No. Okay. I'm surprised you don't know this story about Mojo.
No.
Mojo is probably no. Mojo is. It's considered the unofficial. You're gonna have to Google him when
okay.
I finish. Mojo is the unofficial conductor of who influenced a lot of the guys in Detroit. When I say a lot
is that
of
right?
guys, I'm talking about the guys who started techno.
Yeah.
Derek, Kevin, and Juan.
Yeah.
And me and Jeff. And all those guys that are doing dance music
mm-hmm.
were not only that. The whole city of Detroit was influenced by this guy named Mojo. Mojo was a radio disc jockey. He
okay.
had a show every night, and I forgot how many hours it was, but the cool thing about his show was it was open format.
Yeah.
And he was able to play whatever he wanted to play within this mm-hmm. this time frame,
yeah.
right? So it was opposite of what other radio stations or disc jockeys were
doing. Everything was programmed.
Yeah. He didn't have those constraints.
Right.
So he was able to play B-52s,
mm-hmm.
Gary Numan,
mm-hmm.
Parliament Funkadelic, Prince, da-da. Mojo was credited with breaking Prince in Detroit.
Oh, wow.
Okay, so that's how influential he was.
Yeah.
So before techno even started and before even Juan kind of started, Mojo was playing all this different electronic music on his show.
Mm-hmm.
So he was playing Kraftwerk and all, and I just mentioned all those other,
yeah.
all those other electronic bands from the 80s that black kids would never be exposed to.
Yeah.
He exposed us to that. So if you take that mixture of Kraftwerk with those European influences and then you mix them up with Parliament and Funkadelic and mm-hmm. all that kind of stuff, and you expose it to these young black kids, that's what actually kind of was the precursor to musically
wow.
to techno.
Yeah.
And I'm not the only one who says this. Anybody that you ask.
Yeah.
And the cool thing about Mojo was he had this mystique, and nobody knew what he looked like. And so the whole idea was, and it was perfect because his whole mystique for years was, what does Mojo look like? And he had, I think the name of his show was the mothership or something. So every at the beginning of every show, this spaceship would land, and he would have this whole little spiel. He would say this whole thing, and then he would take you on this journey.
Yeah.
And it was the most amazing thing. So without Mojo, there probably would not have been Techno the way that it started.
Yeah.
And I would put my life on that.
That's amazing.
And so, like, fast forward years later, everybody realized, well, they knew back in the day, but everybody realized this, and they started, you know, saying that this guy was the guy who opened us up. And this was, like, before Jeff Mills did his thing. So Jeff had a DJ show on Detroit radio.
Okay.
And it was probably, and he was called The Wizard.
Mm.
And he was and he was mixing.
I've heard some of the old tapes.
Right, and he was mixing kind of hip-hop and some other stuff together.
Yeah.
And that was not on Mojo's show, but it was on a separate thing.
Okay.
And so it was all right around that time. It was a perfect time for a genre to be born.
Yeah.
And it was the most amazing thing to see this as a kid.
Right.
In the 10th grade, 11th grade, and but not be aware of it. I mean, you're not aware.
Yeah, of course, you're not paying attention.
Right? Art is art. It's gonna go where it goes, and you know, if you're gonna have some kind of constraints, that's gonna fuck it up. So, that's what I saw, and then I graduated in 1986. Already knew what house music was before I left Detroit, right? So, because it was kind of being played on the radio, and then went away to the Air Force in 1986, and then 2 years later said, fuck the Air Force, I want to be a stand-up comic, because that's, you know, that's my first love, stand-up.
Yeah, is that
so
right?
So that's why I moved out to L.A.
So wait, I want to talk about that, but I have a question. So, because you're talking about, you know, just what's going on in Detroit, so, you know, the way we knew it out here, I grew up in San Francisco, which had a similar thing happening with as far as DJs on the radio, really breaking barriers and, you know, disco, hip hop, funk, soul.
DJs or disc jockeys?
Disc jockeys.
Okay, I'm talking about. Okay, right.
Right. But, you know, the first time we heard about Detroit in that context was Clear, right? Juan Atkins, you know, Cybertron. Yeah,
yeah. So which, that's where he took
which,
his...
Which A, we didn't know was Detroit.
Right.
We didn't know it was techno. I mean, it was, you know, it was just a B-boy song.
Yeah, for sure.
And and then we learned later on, in fact, it wasn't until I was at Herb Magazine, and I was surrounded by all these techno and house heads, and then I learned it was the same guy. Which, you know, is...
So guess where Juan took that record to be played? He took it to Mojo.
I'm sure.
And so Mojo was a guy who played Juan Atkins. And that was before techno, the term techno was started.
So what happened in the local scene? What did that record do?
Okay, so there was So during that time before all this real formation of techno, like there was, like Mojo was doing his thing. The Wizard was on the radio. This is 84, 83, 84, 85. Yeah, yeah. Okay.
That's right.
We had these dance shows on TV. One was called The Scene, right? And so it was basically Soul Train, Detroit style, right? And so on this show, you had all this, I don't know what you want to call it, booty music, whatever the fuck, okay, it had the same,
electro,
right, there we go.
Whatever.
Okay, so Juan cleared his stuff, clearly fit in with that. Along with Kano, do you know Kano?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, I'm ready. War. Right, I'm ready. Like, all that stuff, and then Kraftwerk with Numbers, and that was all being played alongside all that black music. And it was
so
just
crazy.
It was a perfect melding of all this stuff.
Yeah.
And it was fucking massively influential and key for them coming up with. It's like you have a petri dish and you put you put something in it and then you put a few other things in it and you see what it's going to grow into. And it was just a perfect environment for that.
So it's so interesting looking back. Like we can look back and all this shit makes sense.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It lines up, right?
Yeah,
you're talking about Kraftwerk. So I'm a couple of years younger than you, but, you know, I used to have a buddy. We would sit in the fifth grade and every Friday we would make our list of our top 20 records. And it was just stuff playing on the radio.
Fifth grade?
Yeah, yeah, fifth grade. We were... And it was KSOL, the Soul Station in San Francisco, and we would like figure out, and all of a sudden, my homeboy brought up the song Numbers. And I was like, what the fuck is that, right? And so I go found it somehow, and I play it, and I'd never heard of Kraftwerk, and I had no idea that style. And I was like, it's a dude saying numbers in different languages I'm like, how is this even a song?
Right.
But it's a brilliant song, and so my point is, like, now we can look back at the history and how all these things influence each other.
Right.
But when you're in it, you don't know any
Planet
of that.
Rock, especially I want to leave that out. Planet Rock, all that stuff that was in the same genre.
Yeah.
And it was all, man, it was such an amazing time.
So stand-up comedy.
Yeah.
So first of all, you said that was your first love. So how did you, what'd you grow up to? Who'd you grow up to?
Richard Pryor and listen to Richard Pryor nonstop. I wasn't a Bill Cosby fan. Thank God. No, I'm kidding. He's funny. Yeah, I grew up watching Saturday Night Live. Saw Eddie Murphy and was like, oh my God, I want to be Eddie Murphy. Because I can do all these in person. Just like Eddie. I'm literally like Eddie Murphy.
Is that right?
But you just take the name out and just put my name in, right? I'm talking about impersonations and stuff.
Okay.
But I wouldn't purposely go on stage and try to be Eddie Murphy.
Sure.
But that was my thing. So when I went away to the Air Force, I was like, fuck this, I don't want to do this.
So were you doing that on stage? Were you going out?
No.
Uh-uh.
So I went away to the Air Force with this house music. Uh-huh. I met a guy from Chicago who was actually my roommate, just by chance. He had turntables and all this house music. I was like, In the Air Force in Florida. It was just weird. Like, oh, shit, you're from Chicago? Oh, shit, house music, oh. So we hooked up, we got really cool.
Yeah.
Playing all this house music, and then I got tired and I was like, you know what? I want to go back home to Detroit and pursue comedy. Ma, I want to come home and do comedy. Okay, let's pause there. Black mothers don't like that shit. What you mean you want to come home and do comedy? Fuck that shit. You better stay in the Air Force and get some benefits, that kind of shit.
Of course.
Right? Black mothers ain't trying to hear that shit. My mom, opposite.
Oh, yeah?
She said, bring it, baby.
Nice.
And I was like, are you serious? And I had never known that I got my sense of humor from my mother.
Okay.
I had never known up until that point that my mom, she told me during that time that she wanted to be a comic when she was a kid. So it made sense why she
went.
So right before I got out, she sent me this thick old envelope of material. And I was like, what the hell is this? I thought it was a letter.
Is that right?
And I opened it up, I was like, why is it thick? It was jokes. And I was like, oh, this is cool. So it was really cool. So I went back to Detroit to pursue comedy.
Yeah.
And I started slowly doing it.
Yeah.
And then I heard this weird sound in the clubs. And I was like, what the hell is this? This is not house music because it's more electronic. I was like, what is this? And so I started going in the clubs in downtown Detroit and met Richie Houghton. Mm. He was at a club.
Mm-hmm.
And me and Richie instantly clicked. And this is before he started even doing music. He was he was discovering it just like I was. I mean, he wasn't playing all, this was 88. So Derek and those guys, they were releasing stuff.
Yeah.
And it was amazing. It was like, what the hell is that? I didn't know who it was or who Derek was. And I was like, what the hell is this? And there was another radio program on the radio every Friday. And it was this crazy-ass sound. It was amazing. And I was like hearing some influences of house. They were playing some house music. But it was other more weird, electronic, emotive strings and shit. And I was like, what the fuck? It was Derek May. He had a radio show.
Mm-hmm.
And he was playing a lot of his own shit.
Yeah.
Mixed in with all the other Detroit-style stuff.
Right.
Kevin Saunders and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
So then the comedy stuff went on the back burner.
Okay.
Because Richie and I,
but you were out doing clubs.
I was not doing the clubs. I was actually taking lessons.
I was taking
classes on how to structure jokes and all that kind of stuff. And before I could even get into it, the music, and I got really wide open. My eyes like, ooh, music.
Yeah.
And then so that's when I stopped the comedy thing. But the reason why I moved out to LA was to get back into comedy.
Is that right?
Yeah. So when I moved out here,
yeah,
I got into comedy.
Okay.
And then I started doing the clubs.
What was your...
Do you remember your
first set?
Oh, yeah. Was that the Improv?
How'd you do?
It was excellent.
What was... Was there a joke? Was there a...
Was
there a joke that got the...
So the reason why... And this is, let me tell you why I did it. The reason why I chose the Improv was because they were offering a
By the way, we're pointing because Improv's right down the street.
Oh, right, yeah, exactly. they were, somebody was, I forgot the same, the girl, the lady comic, who it was because it was years ago. She was famous and she was doing a course. And the reason why I wanted to do this course, not because I didn't know what to do, was because at the end of the course, they would film.
Yeah, they put you on stage.
They would film you on stage at the Improv.
Oh,
so
cool.
That was perfect. So
nice.
I was like, yes. So it was perfect.
Yeah.
It was, and I got, and then so I took that video and I took it around to the other clubs and got showcases that way. And I was at the Laugh Factory.
Oh, nice.
Doing showcases.
Nice.
And, but the only bad thing about it was at the Laugh Factory, you only can do showcases like once every 6 weeks or something like that. So that was kind of conflicting with me going on the road. And like, so I was like, oh, in this weird position about, okay, do I cancel the gig, make no money, and then wait and go on stage and for 3-4 minutes and, and hopefully.
I wonder if you could do the two, like, could you do a comedy set? Could you go on the road, like do a comedy set and then go out and DJ that night?
A lot of people were asking me that stuff and I don't think so.
Yeah.
A pro could do it, but not me. I'm a logical motherfucker. I can't do that because I don't like, really? Because I would, like, some promoters were like, especially in, I don't know why, the UK and Scotland, and I was like, really? You want me to do a comedy? No, that's not.
Oh, like at a nightclub?
Yeah, at a comedy club. And I was are you, seriously?
Yeah.
Nah, I'm not, my chops ain't that hot, right? So that was, actually, I haven't been on stage in a few years because my last show was so fucking bad.
Was it?
Oh. But it happens to everybody. That's the problem. You're supposed to fucking fail. You are supposed to fail in life with everything, right? And then that's where all the lessons are, right? You learn the lessons. And like a dumbass, I did Chocolate Sundays at the Laugh Factory. Do you know Chocolate Sundays?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Of course.
That's not my normal thing. You know what I mean?
I'm
a black guy, but that's not my crowd.
That's a different room.
Oh boy, that's a different room. And I did not.
I was like a long time.
I was like a Bond chick, like, oh my God, Sunday, of course I'll do it. And I was like, that'll be easy, right? And no, it was fucking packed with brothers and sisters, and there was celebrities and shit there.
Right.
Bro, I got on stage and I fucking froze.
Yeah.
I mean, literally, brain just farted, just like, it just completely forgot every fuck, because I had never been in front of a group of not that many people. Right. I mean, just, it was so packed. People.
Yeah, the room is packed.
Oh,
yeah.
And then it was my people, and I know you, it's like the Apollo. Like, if you don't come with it, they go, man. So I forgot my train of thought, and I swear to God, it was 2 minutes, but it was probably 15, 20 seconds of silence.
Right.
And then I remember where I was, then I woke up out of this thing, and then I kind of finished. Then it was over.
Right.
So I got, I was sweating like a,
bruh.
So I got off stage, and then the host was like, y'all got to give it up. This shit is really hard. And that was it.
Yeah.
I fell off the horse, and I was like, fuck that. I'm going to Paris anyway. I don't need this shit. I got gigs in Paris. Blah, motherfucker. And it was a cop-out.
Right.
That crutch that I had, DJing, stopped me from getting back on stage. So now I still have this burning desire to get back on stage, and I'm now wiser than I was before, like then.
So the rule, if I understand, I've never stood up and done comedy yet. I'm terrified of that idea.
Hey, yeah.
But for what I've heard talking to comics is like, you're supposed to get right back out.
You're supposed to literally get back on stage.
Next day or
I mean,
soon
literally.
As you can.
That's the reason why... Why all these talk show hosts, they go to small comedy clubs and they work their jokes out there.
Because
they have the same reaction. Motherfuckers don't laugh and you're like, okay, that ain't funny.
Right.
And then, okay. So what made me feel better about it was like maybe a year later, I saw this this documentary, Jerry Seinfeld. He did his little, this movie about
comedian
getting back into comedy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And what happens on stage? I already knew this.
Right.
What happens on, he forgot his fucking set.
Right.
But he's such, you know, a pro, they wing it until they find their, wait, what the fuck, what was I gonna say? And then he kind of ripped off that, and then he found his place. Okay, that's a professional. Like for me, because I didn't have a support system of comics that I was hanging out with that say, oh, motherfucker, get back on stage. That wasn't shit, I did that shit. I crashed last night or bombed last night.
Right.
I didn't have that. I just freaked the fuck out and went home and got on the plane.
Sure.
And rocked the crowd and came home and was like, see, yeah, I don't need that, right? Okay, so now I'm still hungry as ever to get back on stage.
Yeah.
But now it's still like, you know, my overhead is pretty high.
Yeah, sure.
So it's like, my mom was like, you got to make a decision. Do you want to fucking have all this shit that you called success, material shit?
Right.
Or do you want to
studio for the hottest gear?
And then driving Porsches and shit, yeah. And go through all these expensive ass divorces once every 3 years?
As long as you keep them one at a time.
Right. Yeah. And I'm like, mother! So I think now, because of the YouTube explosion, all these other different ways that you can present yourself, sure. You got all these different other platforms, it's easier to do it now than it was years ago when I last was on stage.
That's so fascinating.
But the cool thing was, you know, X-ing out the bomb of Chocolate Sundays, I was doing great at Laugh Factory. That's why that's why Jamie, the owner, kept giving me these showcases.
Yeah.
And, you know, every Tuesday was when I would do the showcase. And so, and then I had some, I had a friend who was on Felicity. Do you know Felicity, the TV show?
Yeah.
She's an actress. And she came out, and she was in a couple movies. She was like, that is the hardest fucking thing. It is. It's literally the hardest thing to do.
Yeah.
Because as an actress, when an actor, you're on stage, you're reciting whatever the script is. That ain't your work. You don't give, I ain't offended if you don't laugh at this. I didn't write it. Okay, as a comic, you have to fucking say the joke, and if they don't laugh, you got to keep rolling, because that's some personal shit when you write a joke and they don't laugh, you don't get the reaction that you got last night or whatever, and you're like, what? And then, but you got to still keep going. That's also
it's the only place I can think of where people go to hate.
Exactly, right? Some people go to not laugh.
Make me laugh. It's part of the thing, right?
That's it, motherfucker?
You know, you don't get that when you go to the theater.
Right.
You don't get that, you know.
Yeah.
Not everybody's happy with their meal, but generally people go out to enjoy their meal, sure. Right?
Like, yeah.
So yeah, that's a tough.
And it's, you have this band. You have, you know, if you go out long enough, you have the band of brothers that you hang out with, and you kind of support. Actually, I did a night with Michael Richards before that shit happened. Yeah.
Not that night.
No. It was at
that would have been fun.
At the Improv. It was me, him, and another buddy, and he was like, this is life. Just like fucking Kramer.
Sure.
This is the life, isn't it? And I was like, wow, we hang out with fucking Kramer. And then he fucking did that shit. I was like, whoa.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's my main passion. So one day soon, and actually I've never stopped writing jokes.
Yeah.
So I have a ton of jokes that's not... sometimes a lot of people write dated material where you only can say it like I ain't gonna be telling jokes about Nixon.
Right.
You know, Nixon was an asshole, right? That's not, so my shit is more, I can say about, so I, it's not like a intentional thing where I say, okay, I'm not gonna write dated material. I'm just gonna, you can put it, you can drop it in any fucking decade and it still should work.
Sure.
Right. Okay.
Do you, have you ever thought about, do you approach music the same way as comedy, or
it's a bit different.
Yeah.
Because you're tapping different parts of your brain, I think. Okay, you're still on the creative side, but still, you're still drawing from, with jokes, you're drawing from experiences, real experiences, right? And then you kind of exaggerate them. Well, some comics, right? So you kind of over-exaggerate them, and you make them like a caricature. Right, you make it funny, but you got to make it relatable to people, because that's what comedy is, right?
Right?
I can go to India, Mumbai, and tell a joke about growing up in the city, right? And they'd be like, motherfucker, this is not Detroit. I don't get it. What the hell? So you got to have some kind of relatable thing. Music is totally different. Like, I can't go into my studio. I've had the studio probably 2.5 years and probably written only maybe 2 albums worth of material. But I've done a bunch of remixes, but that's how weird I am with music. Like, some people can come into the studio and sit down and just like,
they
have this formula, and just boom. And some other people are, they're just like, they're not like that. I'm not coded like that. Like, I can sit there for literally days and not come up with shit. But then when I find my zone, it's like fucking, cruise control, and you're not even aware. It's just a weird thing.
Hmm.
And my friend was telling me the other day about Salvador Dali and how a lot of these artists, they get inspired, or what they do to get in that zone. And I didn't know that Salvador Dali had this routine that he would go through. Do you know about this?
No.
Okay, what he did was he had this plate.
Okay.
You don't know about this?
No.
Okay, he had a plate.
It was full of acid?
No. He had a plate that he had on the floor, and it wasn't just him, it was a lot of famous artists and people that are inventors and stuff. They would have this plate, and they would take these 20-minute naps.
Mm-hmm.
They were basically sleep deprived.
Right.
And they would sure. they would bring that on. They what they would do was they would have a coin. They put the plate on the floor, have this coin, and then nod off. The coin would fall, drop in the plate. They would wake up and start working. Wow. That's the perfect for me. That was always the perfect time to work.
Is that right?
Was right after I woke up yeah. because your senses are all there. Yeah. So you fucking.
I'm the same way. I like to work.
Okay,
like
so that's the perfect. So that's my point. Like you wouldn't wake up as a comedian and do that because. You might not make sense with, you know what I'm saying? With words.
Sure.
Okay, but with music, it's amazing.
Interesting.
So for me, like, and I'm notorious for being really late with projects and stuff, missing deadlines. But, you know, at the end of the day, like, when I give people the project, they're, like, blown away. And it works, but for as a business thing, no, it doesn't. Like, because sometimes I piss off a lot of people for being so late.
Yeah, no, I get it. You know, so I've, you know, reading about you online, like, definitely I've seen you described as quality over quantity, right?
Because
you haven't had a lot of releases.
No.
But, you know. The stuff you put out has been, very highly regarded.
So the idea is to change that.
Yeah. Bring the quality down.
Bring the quality way down.
Yeah, yeah.
And just that's throw
good.
All kinds of shit on the wall.
That's good.
Left hand. No, that wasn't intentional either. Over the span of my almost 30 years into this shit, like doing this music, it wasn't me saying, okay, I'm only going to do one every 10 years. That's the ticket. No, it just happened to be that way. Then traveling as a DJ, you kind of ride that wave. Mm-hmm. A lot of people do that shit, but like people who really got their shit together, they obviously don't do that. They go, okay, I got this project. We got to put it out. We got the tour. Da, da, da. But the model has changed for music though. It's all completely changed. Back in the day, you would do an album. And then you go on the road to support this album. Actually, now it's reversed.
Yeah.
To get on the road, you need...
You got to have a record.
It's the strangest thing.
Yeah.
It's like a business card.
Right.
Or flyer, the album, the music. It's kind of almost throwaway, kind of. Almost, right? Dance music. Okay, yeah. Within dance music, because a lot of people don't do... A lot of techno producers, they don't do things that you're going to remember a week later. Like the track. So that's my point. Yeah, so I'm trying to do shit that's... more hooky, more memorable. So the remixes I've done in the last, I don't know, 10 years, they've all been like that hooky thing. You go, oh, that's Kenny. I can hear Kenny.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one of the reasons I spent all this money on this gear in my studio was because I wanted to like kind of up my output.
Yeah.
But how do you do that without feeling like you're kind of compromising the process? I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, so what is the process to get in that zone for you? I mean, I think, you know, we were talking about earlier, like, my observation is that part of the process for you is investing in gear, which I think we don't notice as listeners, but you notice. Like, you get a new piece of gear,
that inspires
you to go use it.
It's a double-sided coin there. Like, it's bullshit on one coin. Like, okay, I need this. No, you don't need shit, right? When I first started back in the day, I had two pieces of gear and you did your track and everything.
For sure.
Now, but on the flip side, my mentality is if it does inspire you to work, then get it. Like, why bottle your why put your creativity in a box and try to fucking structure it? Don't. So, especially if now, a lot of people, you know, when I get a lot of new gear, I post about it, and people go, really? You need another synthesizer? Why do you need another synthesizer? People get mad. How you gonna get fucking mad because homeboy got a new synth?
Right.
Why are you mad at me?
Right.
Right? And they get mad.
Because
it inspires, it makes me sit down and work. You look at the lights, you go, ooh, lights, pretty lights and knobs and shit. Whereas some people, they have their laptop, and they have a little tiny MIDI keyboard, and that's all they need with all their plugins, and that does it for them. Me, I'm more of a touchy-feely guy. I like to compare it to porn. Like, do you want to just watch porn on a laptop or you want a bunch of bitches in the room and you touching the knobs? Hey, what's up, girl? You're doing your thing.
Right.
But you get the same result, but it's like, or it's like a...
The process is very different.
Exactly. Yeah. Or it's like a flight simulator. You got a flight simulator on the laptop, or you can buy the real plane and drive the... Okay.
Yeah.
That's so for me, like I like that. I don't feel like I have to go out and buy something every 2 months. No, but if there's something that that's gonna up my creativity and productivity and, mm-hmm. and make me more efficient in the studio, why not? Fuck it. So that's my opinion. My intention is not to say to kids that are coming up who wants to do music, you got to do the same thing. That's not what you have to do. You start small. Actually, I did a post last week on Facebook about, I forgot which piece of gear that I bought. I forgot what it was. Anyways, the guy said, he said, oh, that's an amazing piece of gear. I'll never be able to, how am I going to start doing music? I will never be able to. I said, bro.
Because he doesn't have that gear. He can't afford
it,
whatever.
Don't shoot for what I have. I said, start small. You don't have to start. Don't get discouraged because you've seen other people buying all the. Because it's all perception. Like social media is this perceived idea about, don't do that. I said, don't start. And then all these other people, fans, started chiming in, saying to the guy, yeah, just get this for $200. And it was cool to see them.
Definitely.
See other people realize that and know what I'm doing is not necessarily the same path that you should take mm-hmm. because, you know, if you can afford it, you would probably end up buying it. If you can't afford it, then you have to figure something else out, just absolutely. Like everybody else does, right? So, it's a complicated process. It's not like something you can like put your finger on and say, okay, this is what inspires me, and this is always going to be the thing that inspires me. And music, I mean, being creative isn't like that. It should be this free, wild thing that's morphing into this and just not constrained. You know what I mean? Like the minute you try to box it up and try to sell it and go, this is what creativity is. Like, nah, I'm on a totally different plane than just.
So for me, I don't make music, but I write. Mm-hmm. And what I find is that I have to write some stuff that I hate and throw it away, mm-hmm. and then I write something that I like. I don't know if you have that type of experience. Well, hate's maybe a strong word, but I always write something, and I'm like, oh, that's no good.
I thought you meant you intentionally write something.
No.
Okay, right.
But the first, not even the first draft, because it might be something totally different.
Okay.
But I kind of have to get like the garbage out of my system.
That's kind of how, like, I'm doing a few remixes now.
Yeah.
And I always end up using the 15th version. I can do 14 different versions and go at the last one, this is the one, right? And then, actually, I don't throw away the other ones. I shelve them and then go back to them later. Because what I usually do when I do a remix is they send me the stems and I go, okay, I'm not using any of that. And then I just use some little tiny snippet and then rewrite the whole song.
Yeah.
And that's why people contact me to do these remixes, because they know I'm going to fucking rewrite the whole song.
Right.
But it's going to take some time, you know. And I say, like, look, it's going to take a minute. And they, okay, no, we're cool. And then 2 weeks later, they're like, are you finished? And I'm like, motherfucker, I told you. It's gonna take me. No, I mean, when I say time, I mean 6 months, bro. When my first kid comes, man, then I'm a.
Right.
So, yeah. If you figure out the formula for being constantly creative, like, let me know, because it's a hard one. It's like a, I don't know, it's like a, this elusive thing. I can be down there every day, but like get two songs finished in a week maybe, and then throw one of the songs away and go, that's not gonna work. And it's dance music. It's not like I'm writing for Britney Spears or whatever.
I don't know, that music is equally,
oh, for sure.
I don't want to say disposable, because that sounds more negative, but I think,
absolutely.
Like,
yeah, for sure.
But right? I think music in general has gone in that direction. Dance music has been there for a long time.
Cool thing about dance music is it's one of the only genres that allows old people to still be in the game.
Mm.
Right? Like, I started 30 years ago.
Right.
And I'm in control of however much I want to be on the road or what you want. Like, you're literally in control of that shit. The only bad thing about us doing it, and when I say us, I mean people of color, is that we don't get exposed to those high dollar.
Sure.
I just saw something 2 days ago about Calvin Harris, like $280 million dollar deal.
Stupid money.
In Vegas. That does not compute. You know when astrophysicists say there's like a billion different universes, and you like, you can't wrap your head around that. You're like, what do you mean there's a billion? How the fuck do they know that shit?
Sure.
So yeah, it's like, how the hell? I don't understand that. Somebody interviewed Quincy Jones a couple of years, I don't know if it was Rolling Stone or whatever, and he completely like dogged.
Oh yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do.
He completely dogged techno. He was like, that fuck, I hate fucking techno. And they asked him why, and he said because it's because they put all these studio musicians out of work, because everybody's using synthesizers and shit, number one. And number two, when you go on tour, it's just two CDs and a mixer.
Right.
And they're making $50, $60 million. And then you got these other people like Normal Music not even making that. And it's huge productions. And he's like, I hate that shit. It's like, wow.
I mean, I think, look, it's not his generation.
Yeah, yeah.
Right? He didn't have that experience like we had in terms of time and place.
Yeah.
So I
understand what he said. I understood.
I can totally understand
that. Oh, for sure. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think for me, too, like, you know, I actually have sort of the opposite experience. I love going to see DJs. I don't really love going to see live music. Right. With some exceptions.
Yeah, yeah.
But just to see a band just because I happen to like the album or whatever. Yeah, yeah. I don't need to see them do it over in front of me.
But that alone is mind blowing because, okay, when you say you're gonna go see a live act, usually you're talking about rock or something, right?
Maybe, or you know, well, I mean.
Okay, yeah. My point is like, can you name?
I mean, live hip hop is generally not good.
Okay, that's not, usually. I ain't talking about rap, let's leave rap out of it. Okay. That's not a band. When you say
Right.
Okay.
Sure.
There ain't no black bands like Earth, Wind & Fire, like those kind of bands.
Well, I would go see Earth, Wind & Fire. Definitely,
okay, that's my point.
Like, we're talking about Motown.
Right,
you know,
modern day, you don't have that kind of stuff.
I saw Smokey last year.
Smoke, oh, really?
It was one of the best shows I've ever seen in my life.
But he's
maybe
still
the
from
best.
That, from yeah. that, I'm talking about today, like there is nothing like that.
No.
No, like... So it's normal for, like you just said, oh, go see. Like this girl came into my studio the other day. She goes, she's from the other studio that's in my, and she started listing off all this Calvin Harris, and she started naming all these guys. I was like, who the fuck? I don't know who these guys, Marshmello and all this. I was like, what? Who this? And I Googled them and it's like top 10. And it's like, I don't even know who those people are. So it's just amazing to see these guys, these kids, they're making tens more millions of dollars than like these huge acts that
are
doing, it's insane. And who would have thought that like 15 years ago that it would blow off so hard in the States? Because it was, they used to give us the finger. They still
For
give
sure.
us the finger, right? Dance For music, sure. the yeah. genre, before this EDM thing blew up. Mm-hmm. And now it's this fucking massive genre.
So did that affect you in any way?
No, that's
not. I mean, obviously that's not what you do, but from the outside.
No, like, I mean, I'm
the outside who, doesn't understand the difference between EDM and techno.
Well, I'm going to tell you who affected the most, and it's the guys who started. Okay, so I'm in this multi-thread text every day.
Yeah.
Derek May, Kevin Saunderson, Carl Craig, Stacey Pullen. So we all talk old man shit, you know, old people bitch about shit.
Yeah,
so
of course.
What do you think is the main topic?
Marshmallow.
Well, no, it's that
I mean,
kind of thing.
No, it's not
right,
him,
the fact that, oh, we don't, how come we don't make the money?
Right.
Those three guys, the guys who started, because they started this genre and they don't get those same kind of opportunities.
Right.
And it's too late. I mean, how can you, like...
It is too late.
Kids don't care about where the music came from. They just care about the experience that they get when they go to these big-ass shows and they see the lights and...
Well, I'm going to tell you what you all should be doing. Not that it's my place to tell you anything, but... is collaborating with those people, right? You know, we started a conversation saying like, the fans might not know you, but the artists know you, right?
So
you've inspired them.
Yeah.
And when I say you, I'm talking about everybody on that text.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, has inspired these next generations. Yeah. And that's where, you know, you saw the Tony Bennett collaborated with, I forget
Lady
who
Gaga.
It was, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Or you saw Nat King Cole and right?
Sure.
Like. That's how generations get bridged.
Yeah, yeah,
And so, you know, that takes a bit of putting everybody's ego to the side.
Yeah.
Right? And
Kevin did a remix for, who was that? It was like 2 years ago. It was a huge act. And, it was, actually, that was an older act. I think it was, I forgot who it was. But anyways, yeah, you're right. And it's funny because we're right on the fringes of those circles.
Yeah.
They know who we are. They all know who we are.
Of course.
Who we are, right?
Yeah.
And so this studio that I have downtown, there's four studios in my big suite, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there's one guy who's he's a really I don't want to say he's not famous like Bob Clearmountain famous, but he's a mixing engineer. So he mixes down like Rihanna and Snoop and Big Sean, all those big hits.
Yeah.
Beyonce. And so I see his clients going in and out.
Yeah.
And then they come and see my setup. They're like, what the fuck? Who are you? You got all this shit. Like, because the mixing engineer doesn't have any. He has a laptop. I'm sorry. He has his computer, Pro Tools, and a few pieces of gear, and that's it. I'm the one with the and he was like doing all the big studios down the street. Mm-hmm. And he was mm-hmm. right. So here I am with this high end setup, and they're like curious about, okay, what do you do? So I tell them, and then they're curious and interested. Oh, and totally. The funny thing is that their only exposure to dance music, obviously, is the EDM shit.
Yeah.
So they're like shocked that there's a black people do dance music. Are you serious? EDM? Like, no. Not EDM. And it's not EDM. It's more tech. So I got to run down this whole spiel, and then they go do their investigation. So eventually, somehow, they're going to cross. I don't know how it would. I think I would still need some kind of representation to make that happen, though.
Sure.
I mean, even though they come in and out all the time.
Yeah, sure, of course.
Here.
Yeah.
But it would be cool. Like, I mean, that's one of the reasons, another reason why I bought all that high-end shit. It's not just to do techno. Like, I mean, you could do that on some laptop speakers. Snare roll and be out, right? I'm so anti-snare roll, I refuse to put a snare roll in my track.
So what's inspiring you now musically?
Man, like, to not listen to music.
Okay.
Yeah, that for me.
But I'm just saying, like, so if talked about early on, it was mojo, it was Kraftwerk, it was this energy,
right,
that was informing your music.
Yeah.
Is it still the same, or has it changed?
Now I fall back to I'm old now. I'm 50. Mm. I fall back to jazz shit. Right.
Yeah.
When I do listen to music, it's mainly jazz. Or
what kind of jazz?
Miles and shit like that. Like the real shit, right? Mm-hmm. And then, but. Current stuff, I ain't got no time for that shit. Like that hip hop, I don't know what the fuck that shit is. Okay, you can stand back and look at it as a spectator and go, huh? Like you some of the stuff you can get with for a minute, then you can go, okay. When you start, if you listen to it for a portion of time, then you go, okay, this is definitely a formula. I mean, they're literally just taking the one guy out and putting them with the other guy, and then you have the same style of it, like that trap shit. Like, it's all the same for me.
Yeah.
And for me, that's really super boring. I there's been some stuff technically that I've been like, oh, okay, from a producer standpoint or from an artist goal, oh, that's a cool ass sound, how they pitched the hi-hat down. And then,
Right.
And then, but as far as being inspired by that, no. I'm like Jeff. Like, Jeff intentionally does not try to listen to other dance music, right? Because then you get influenced.
Yeah.
In some way, directly or indirectly, by other stuff. So that's what I tried to do, is to not listen to a lot of new stuff, because then, you know, I just fall back on my own stuff to get me to do this music. But if I were to do a remix, I might get some kind of thing off of the remix, but as far as like listen to music every day, radio every day, no. I'm more wrapped up in this stupid ass politic bullshit, man. Bro, I'm so gone in this shit.
Yeah.
And that, honestly,
does that impact your music?
Oh my God! It's like anything impacts creativity like that. Anything like that, a divorce or a separation from your girl.
Of course.
Some people can cut that off and go into the studio and knock that shit out, right? Well, maybe because they paying $500 an hour for the studio, so they ain't got no choice. But when you own the studio and you can do things at your leisure, everything affects me. Like, so now, like I can't get away from this shit. Like, it's so engrossing.
So how did, like, you know, rock and roll in a lot of ways was protest music. Obviously not all of it, but that was a big part of what happened in the 60s, 70s with rock. Hip hop was protest music, you know, soul to some extent. Is it that type of influence that you think it's having, or is it more subtle than that?
The politics?
No, yeah. Right, traditionally, I guess what I'm saying is traditionally, music has been an outlet for people to express their outrage about political, social issues.
Yeah.
You know.
But
are you still seeing that, or are you experiencing
it? Not with dance music. I don't think not with dance music, because the key thing that's different between dance music and all those other genres that you mentioned is that they have lyrics in these other genres.
Sure.
Techno doesn't really have. But we can still bring the same amount of people together,
right?
Yeah. But it's lyricless, usually, right?
Absolutely.
So you don't really have the same kind of impact that you would if you had, you know, I don't know what some of those old rock lyric songs, and they're fucking getting them going.
Sure.
We just have this, fucking harder. You go to Germany, fucking play harder. Like, bro, I don't play that hard.
Right.
I play funky.
Yeah, German's like it hard.
Well, yeah, Spain is the same.
Like, is that right?
The kids, that's the, like you said, okay, so this might be a substitution because, you know, you don't, they don't have punk music and all that kind of shit anymore, mm-hmm, but they have mm-hmm. this hard style music and they want it hard. They're drinking, they're fucking on drugs, and they want just fucking, but the girls, you know, they don't want that shit. So you right. gotta, I'll play for the girls more sure. than the guys.
Right.
But I kind of go up and down with my.
Which is like we associate that more with Chicago than Detroit,
yeah,
traditionally,
sure.
right?
Yeah, for sure. Oh, like my man who passed away yesterday, Keith, like mm-hmm. he was like, that was, well, yeah. I mean, even then, well, okay, his lyrics were pretty, but they weren't like political. They were more
right.
smack my bitch up.
Sure.
I'm the yeah. fire starter.
It was anger. It was
yeah. So he had that
teenage
angst.
Teenage angst.
For sure.
For
right?
sure.
And you saw yeah. it in the, you know, I saw some clips of the festivals that they did.
Yeah.
And they were fucking amazing. They were playing in front of, well, they were at Glastonbury, all those huge festivals. I played at Glastonbury, but it wasn't like the main stage.
Sure. Yeah. So what's the vision now? You got, you're back in the studio.
Yeah.
You're thinking about some comedy. Where do you want
well,
it to
go? I finished three remixes.
Okay. Which ones?
This guy named Guti. I don't know if you know Guti.
No.
Guti, you've heard of Martinez, brother?
Uh-huh. Okay. Yeah, yeah.
They have a label, and this guy Guti is he from Argentina? He's from, anyway, he's on the Martinez Brothers.
Okay.
Level. He's a pianist.
Nice.
Jazz pianist.
Oh, cool.
And he does dance music. He's pretty big. And so I did two remixes for him.
Nice.
And that's coming out on Record Store Day.
Mm.
And then I just finished up this other remix for this guy. It's called You and Me. And then I have a Kenny Larkin single that's coming out on Kevin Saunders' label.
Nice.
It's called Step Back. And it was awesome. It was supposed to come out like a year ago. And it was a snafu in the plan. It was a copyright issue.
It happened.
So right, and so I had to deal with that shit. And then,
right,
and then I'm actually working on another album too. So.
Oh, cool.
This year, this month was my 25th anniversary.
Nice.
For my first album that I released on Warp 25 yeah. years ago. Wow. So I just did a distribution deal with this company over in England, and so they want me to re-release this mm-hmm. this album. So
nice.
So. This is probably 2019 is probably going to be the biggest
That's
year
asthma?
As far yeah.
You're going to re-release? Nice.
Yeah, it's going to be the biggest release schedule for me
uh-huh.
as far as music goes because I've never released this much music.
Great.
So the idea is to kind of keep the momentum yeah, going yeah. And constantly release stuff. So in the meantime, yes, I'm going to definitely get back into the comedy. I just don't know how I'm going to approach it or how I'm going to do it.
Sure.
It won't be the traditional way though because right. that didn't work. And it still won't work.
Definitely not chocolate sundae.
Fuck chocolate sundaes. I don't like chocolate. No, I mean like just going to the clubs and hitting all the clubs. Like that's not going to be the venue. That's not going to be the way to right. get where I want to be. It's going to have to be some other different way.
Yeah.
So that's
okay,
it, bro.
I got a lightning round before we get out of here. What's your favorite city to travel to?
Oh, Paris.
Yeah.
Yeah, Paris is the shit. For the honeys.
For sure.
Moscow's the shit for the...
Oh, I bet.
Oh my God! I've never been. That whole region, bro. Anyway, I don't want to come off as some kind of asshole. Well, you know.
I get it.
Yeah.
Who's your favorite DJ?
Probably Derek for energy and Derek May.
Yeah.
For energy and he can connect with the crowd in a different way than any without having to fucking raise his hands. Yeah, that's something I refuse to do is raise my hands. I will not, I'm gonna fucking do this. I'll pump my fist, but I ain't raising my hand because everybody's doing it. Everybody wants to fucking do the same. I'm not gonna do that.
Yeah.
Lemmings.
There's a great, Dennis and I always have argument about DJs because he's always down on it. Because he's a DJ. Oh. And he's like, what we do is easy, right? And, I sent him, there's a video I saw of Derek online that just incredible.
Oh, so you see what I'm saying then?
Yeah.
He was in play in front of
him. I haven't seen him live. I saw him live years ago.
But
just, you know, seeing him on stage, it's amazing.
You just don't see that kind of chemistry.
Well, it's like with him, you know, and some, you know, it's to some extent it's true for all DJs. It's like the music's coming through them.
Yeah.
What's the last great book you read?
I read technical books now.
Do you?
Nothing but technical books. For the studio.
Okay.
That's the most boring shit.
Is there one that's most helpful for what you're doing?
Yeah.
Or you're just talking about manuals?
Manuals and shit. No, and studio techniques and stuff like that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay. But also manuals too. I just bought another synth last week. Nice. The synth that was in the Blade Runner. Ooh, Blade Runner. I bought the synth and I just read the manual. It's nice. Awesome. It's a great read.
So for a young producer, what book should they read?
YouTube is like a fucking. Yeah. I mean, it's so easy to get up on your game.
It's a game changer. So my son, I told you, he's 9 and he's learning to play guitar and drums, mm-hmm. and I teach him to DJ a little bit.
Yeah, yeah,
and it's like we're constantly going to YouTube and like, you want to know how to play that song? Like,
right.
There's a tutorial for sure.
Yeah. So for me, if you were to ask me about books, I would say, Ixnay the book says, go to YouTube.
Yeah.
Honestly, I mean, you know.
Yeah. What movie have you seen the most in your life?
Oh my God. Probably Blade Runner.
Mm.
Star Wars.
Yeah.
Yeah. Interstellar's the shit.
Oh yeah.
Man, I'm really, for me, a sci-fi guy. Yeah, for sure. But I'm talking about just like, I'm so into like visuals when I'm mm-hmm. working on music. So I have this big screen
above
my studio and then I put the movies on and
nice.
I get inspired to, hopefully.
That's cool.
Right, so.
Yeah. Tell me one decision that changed your life forever.
Getting married the first time. Getting married to the wrong person. I'm not saying she's a bad person. It was just the wrong person.
Not right
and
for
too
you.
Fast. And yeah, that was not the right move because it kind of if you don't listen to your gut, and that's with anything, like and you screw up, you know, you'll survive it, but it's, you know, I wish I would have had those 3 years back. Oh, sorry, 5 years back.
Like you said though, that's where the lessons are.
That's where the lessons are.
Sometimes we don't want those lessons, but
we need them. Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I
get it.
Yeah.
Okay, complete this sentence. I don't have talent. I have blank.
I don't have talent. I have blank. Jokes. I got jokes.
Now I'm gonna come see you do some comedy. So if I work for you, what's something I would hear you say over and over?
The typical cliche shit.
Yeah.
Do better. Like my brother, he comes into the studio and he's working on something. I'm like, bro, you can do better than that. So yeah, push yourself. Do better.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. Because it's easy to fall into the same vibe with dance music because it's not a lot of ingredients. You got a drum machine and you got a few synths and they're mainly all analog synths. So they all kind of do the same sound.
Sure.
So I'm like, bro, you gotta, if you don't stick out, because he wants to be a DJ, I'm like, A, you're trying to be a DJ at 50. That's a fucking huge thing.
Yeah.
B, there's a million other fucking DJs out there now, right? If you want to stand out, you got to push when he plays me something. I'm like, that's not going to do it. You have to do something better than that.
Yeah.
And something unique. I mean, you can either make it all sound like, because I'd literally like sit there and go through 100 different melodies and go, okay, which one would be the most hooky so I can stand out from the rest of that shit. I'm like saying to him, bro, you want to, okay, I'm not going to say that.
So I know we talked about the people that you know, you've influenced, you know, and when they recognize you. Mm-hmm. So who would you be most excited to learn and appreciate your work?
I don't know. That's a good one. I don't know. I don't think there's anybody that I would be like, oh, really? He knows my shit? That's awesome.
What about on comedy? If somebody was in the back of the room and
I met
came
Eddie
up
Murphy.
And, you did?
Yeah. And I said to him at a coffee bean.
Did you do an impression for him?
No. I walked up to him. He did the stereotypical thing in L.A. where they put the hoodie on and all the jewelry and that Ed Hardy shit. And I'm like, okay, yeah, you really blend the fuck in, right? Really? Like, so I walked up to him. I was like, bro, I grew up to your shit. Like, oh, yeah, that's great. And I was like, I want to be a comic too. He's like, so? Okay. No,
what you want me to do?
He didn't say that. Yeah, so if I were to go for what my dreams were and to do this comedy thing and then Eddie Murphy, that would be like, or if Richard Pryor was alive, he was his wife actually sent me a message on MySpace years ago.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I forgot why she sent me this message. I think I was talking about Richard Pryor on MySpace and I had the following. And she said, I don't know how that happened, but it was really weird to get a message from her.
Yeah.
Yeah. But like first dance music, I mean, I'm so used to already knowing that there's a lot of guys that are huge that we influence. Yeah. Like, so it's cool to know, but yeah.
You talk about Eddie Murphy. I don't, you know, I watched Raw not too long ago, and it just, one of the things that stood out to me, I mean, it's still funny, but like, is I don't think he could get away with half those jokes anymore.
Why?
Just the politics, the all the gay jokes.
Oh, right, yeah, and, yeah, right, you know, right. Yeah, yeah, for sure.
You know, it's just...
Maybe just the gay joke. What else is there that's the most... offensive, yeah. Yeah. PC, like that.
Yeah, it might have just been that.
Maybe just the gay jokes. Everything else, everything else is kind of.
So not half, but definitely like, you know, his, you know, when he came out, that was shocking.
Yeah, for sure.
Right, and that's part of what we appreciated about him.
Yeah, yeah.
Is that he said shit that was on people's minds.
Right,
and
right.
We didn't have a voice of our own.
Yeah.
And I just don't know you can do that anymore.
I think you can. I think people are numb to the shit, honestly. Like,
maybe.
They're numb to, like,
well,
it depends
also,
on what the topic is.
It's also so different because, you know, he had his moment that was his own, mm-hmm. meaning, like, he was so dominant in pop culture mm-hmm. at that moment mm-hmm. where nobody gets that anymore.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right? Like, you have a big,
right.
you know,
superstar. Right.
Kevin Hart has a big special.
Right, right.
But
right.
there's another big special tomorrow.
Right.
And
right,
it's like,
right, right.
none of it has yeah. the same kind of meaning
right,
culturally.
Right, sure.
So yeah, maybe you're not under the same sort of.
Did you see the Never Leaving Neverland?
I'm building up my strength to watch.
Oh my God!
I don't know if I can,
bro. Okay, so after it's a 2-part series, 2 hours each part, and then Oprah does a thing, and she was mentioning that she was saying how you don't have the caliber of mega star that shines right. that bright,
yeah.
that hard anymore. That's,
yeah,
Michael was probably one of the last.
Yeah, for sure.
So yeah, I agree. There's not a Kevin's huge, but he still doesn't have. I mean, he has a certain charisma to get him where he is, but he still doesn't have.
And I don't even know if it's them. I think it's just culturally, like there's just so much content coming at us from everywhere.
For sure,
right?
And I think.
And so we saw Raw. That was the first one, Raw, or Delirious. Raw was first.
I think Raw was first, yeah.
Whatever
it was.
We saw it in the theater.
Yeah.
My mom took me to a Live on Sunset strip in the theater, right?
Right, right.
Even though I was a little young. Mm. But, you know, those were big moments in our lives, right?
Yeah,
and then you
yeah.
would go home, you'd get the album, you'd memorize.
All that shit, right, right.
All of it, right?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
the same with records.
Yeah,
you'd
yeah.
go get a record and you'd play it 1,000 times and memorize every song and whatever.
Well, everybody's ADD now.
Yeah.
News feed, 5 seconds, boom, and it's gone.
So you hear a song and you're like, oh, that's a great song. And then it's like, it's gone.
It's for sure. For sure.
That's not really the song's fault, mm-hmm. right? That's just the environment we live in.
Well, guess what? And see, he's on his shit right now.
No, he's taking notes.
I'm kidding.
He's working.
It's the oddest thing to fucking like in
for
like
sure.
5 seconds it takes. 10 seconds you have something.
Yeah.
And then boom, it's just gone.
Yeah.
Because you're so over inundated with information and it's just coming at you from every and it's like hard to stay focused and stuff.
Well, dude, I appreciate you, man. This is a great story. Great lessons.
I rambled and blambled. You know how old black people do. That's old black man. You know, when I was a young man, it was.
I love it, man. I love it. I love all the stories.
I appreciate you inviting me down, man. I had fun.
Of course. We'll come back anytime you want to promote something.
Yeah, no, all right.
You're always welcome.
For sure.
How does everybody find you online? Where should we?
What's my Instagram? Kenny Lark. Kenny Larkin Official.
Kenny Larkin Official.
Kenny Larkin Official.
On Instagram.
On Instagram.
We'll be watching for the new releases.
Yeah. And maybe one day tell a joke or two.
Yeah, man. Let us know. We'll come.
Yeah, for sure, man.
Come see you.
Thank you, sir.
Or we'll watch you on YouTube.
Yeah, something like that. Actually, I have a video.
Yo, that was Kenny Larkin on Rebel Radio. I hope you enjoyed it. I know I did. Make sure you leave us a comment or a review on iTunes. On Twitter, you can hit us at Rebel Radio Net. On Facebook, same thing. You can find videos of many of our episodes on our YouTube page at Rebel Radio Net. And most importantly, come back next week for more Rebel Radio. Peace.